In this module, we'll be looking at receiving EDI messages with BizTalk Server. We'll start in Lesson 1 by learning about the EDI receive side architecture and how the EDI components are integrated into BizTalk Server. In Lesson 2, we'll learn about EDI party resolution, or how with EDI messages, BizTalk figures out the sending and receiving party. In Lesson 3, we get a deeper understanding of interchange processing. And in Lesson 4, we'll look at some things such as acknowledgements, debatching, and reporting that enable us to do more advanced scenarios with EDI. In Lesson 1, then, we'll begin with the receive-side architecture. So we'll get an understanding of some of the highlights of BizTalk's EDI solution and understand how that's integrated into the BizTalk components. BizTalk's EDI solution sets out to meet the needs of most companies that are doing EDI interchange, and therefore it supports a pretty rich set of schema subsets of X12 and EDIFACT. It has parity with the previous HIPAA accelerator, so all of the HIPAA schemas and things that were part of that accelerator before in terms of the EDI components have been pulled into the base EDI infrastructure. We've got other schema variants. It's Drummond Group certified in terms of the AS2 solution, or the encryption model that can be used, is often used with EDI. There's a migration tool because one of the components of BizTalk Server 2010 that was enhanced was the trading partner management. So if you're upgrading from BizTalk 2009, for example, you'll be able to run this tool to move your trading partner configuration to the new model. And one of the nice things about the current implementation of EDI and BizTalk is that it's all based on pipeline components and not restricted to particular adapters. And this allows it to really be transport neutral in many cases, so that you could use HTTP or file or FTP, whatever kind of transport or adapter that you need to, and still add all of the EDI processing on top of that. On the receive side, you can see we can use any particular adapter, and then we use a receive pipeline here for EDI or another flavor such as the AS2 EDI receive pipeline, or even custom pipelines using the EDI components to do all of the EDI processing on the message. Party resolution to figure out who the sender is and the receiver. We can look up information about how to disassemble that message from the schemas, for example. All of that's going to happen in the pipeline, and we then flow through our standard BizTalk processing, where any maps that match that source message would be applied on the receive port, messages published to the message box, and then any send port or set of send ports or orchestrations can receive and process the message. In the second lesson, I want to focus on the EDI party resolution, or the mechanism by which the EDI system figures out the sending and receiving parties. So we'll look at how a party gets involved in these EDI interchanges and how you manage those parties. We'll also see how agreements are managed now in BizTalk Server 2010. We'll see some of the fallback settings or global settings that can kick in if you don't supply vendor-specific settings. And then we'll look at the EDI resolution, the EDI on X12 configuration, so all the different details that you configure when you set up an interchange like this, and how we manage the profiles and the agreements that go along with that. And finally, we'll look at how do I manage the configuration for an inbound port? How do I manage the setup for inbound EDI messages? And at the end, we'll look at a demonstration of how to configure those EDI party settings. So you can see the tool being used and you'll see how to apply those settings. EDI relies heavily on the party system within BizTalk Server. A big part of how it figures out what to do with a particular message is by first figuring out the involved parties. And so as you set up your system, one of the things you'll do with a typical EDI scenario is define all the parties involved in your exchanges. Then you have the ability to identify agreements, which lay out the relationship between those parties. And that helps you identify the sending and receiving partner on each of the different kinds of interchanges, and apply configuration for those specific interactions. It provides a really nice model of laying out your agreements that are, you know, set out in a business sense in your technical tool to be able to identify all the appropriate settings and agreed upon exchanges so that things work between your various systems. The components that get invoked within the pipeline then use that information in the party. They use information coming out of the message in the form of context properties to resolve who the particular parties are, find out what the various settings are that should be used, and then apply those settings as appropriate while processing the message. You can see here the relationship where you're going to have a party. The party has a particular profile, and then they can also have a set of identities. And these are simply the identifiers, the name value pairs really, or types of identifiers such as DUNS numbers or, you know, mutually agreed upon settings with EDI that identify that particular party and that particular profile. So these allow you to use different identifiers within your messages and still resolve those to a particular party and their profile. We also have the ability to set up protocol or transport settings here so that for a given profile, you can lay out the default X12 and EDIFACT settings for that particular profile. And you can set those up for both of those types. So you might have a default setting of X12 settings for that profile. You may have a set of EDIFACT settings for that particular profile as well. And then finally, we have the agreements. And those are really going to be tied to a particular profile here, but they're also going to help associate to another party and its particular profile to tie all these things together. You can see an example of that here with an agreement where when we set up that agreement, we're going to choose two different partners or parties. We're going to choose their particular profiles and then a set of their properties. So in this case, we're defining an agreement where we're going to do an interchange with X12. And so we've got a set of properties that have been identified on each of the parties that are then going to get applied and be part of that agreement. Now, if you don't specify settings for a particular party or their profile, you can also have what are called global or fallback settings, where you can identify that if particular settings aren't specified, this is what should be used. And this sometimes is just enough. If you just have a very simple installation with not very many involved parties, maybe just your organization and one other, or your department and another, then this might be enough. You don't need to set up the parties. But generally what this is for is making sure that you have some sort of fallback if you miss something in the setup, and you've got some sort of a failsafe that might kick in and may allow your interchange to work, even if you don't have all the exact settings on a particular party, or to give you some defaults here so that you don't have to configure things on parties if they're just going to follow the defaults. I mentioned that one of the key things is that party, and so as messages are received, it's really important that the system and those pipeline components are able to resolve the party. So that party qualifier, the different values are there, but we can also specify on those agreements and the settings for those protocols, the specific notion of what kind of identifier we're going to use and what value is going to be in there. So you can see here the setup that EDI uses to try and resolve that information. So it's going to try and look at for those different exchanges, either the ISA segments or the UNB 2 and 3 segments here, to go and look at that sender and receiver information. If it can't find a match for both, then it may go and just look for the sender specific information only. So if we're receiving messages in and it can figure out who the sending partner is, we've got the ability to identify on our parties and our profiles what the kind of home profile is or the in-house profile. And then it falls back to the BizTalk party information, or might have multiple senders that just have a common set of EDI processing. And finally, it'll fall back to those global settings if it can't figure out who the particular party is that sent this information. Now, when we go into configure these different protocols and settings, we're going to do that on the profile in the BizTalk administration console. So we could go in and add the settings. And again, we separate out between X12, EDIFACT, and even the AS2. And all of this is supported in the management console. But of course, you can manage all of this stuff programmatically too if you needed to customize on-ramping of parties, you needed to provide a different kind of interface for managing these things. In the profile, you're going to have basic information about the party and their description, some business identifiers, and then those properties we've talked about. The agreement gets down into information about the contact for that particular agreement, who are the different business partners that are involved in this exchange and that should be contacted, and specifying the protocol settings specific to that agreement. When you configure those agreements and you set these things up, you're going to identify, for example, the inbound settings. When BizTalk is receiving messages from the party, what do we want to do? And so this is where you get a chance to drill into the specific settings for your EDI interchange and manage things such as the duplicate control numbers, to call out the default namespace that's used by that particular party, and do any kind of custom definition of transaction sets and processing. In this demonstration, we'll take a look at configuring the default or the fallback settings. We'll create a party and some identities, set up the EDI protocols, and also configure an agreement between parties. This demonstration will be looking at creating parties for use with EDI and configuring EDI settings. So here I am in the BizTalk server administration console. And if you'll notice, I have the parties node selected here. I can either right click to get to the fallback settings for X12 or EDIFACT. And I can also see over here in the actions pane that I can go in to the actions to fire up the dialog to set those settings as well. So you can see here we enable the fallback settings that enables the components that are processing messages to look to these fallback settings if they don't find specific settings for a particular partner. And as we go over here to the dialog, you can see all the different settings that we can select over here around the exchanges to use as a fallback. So you can see, for example, that we're going to have fallback settings for a particular sender ID and receiver ID that's going to use the mutually identified items here. We're not going to have any authorization information. We've got fallback settings for acknowledgments that indicate that no acknowledgments will be set here. So all of these different settings are things that we can fall back to. We'll also see that we can configure those on a particular party. So let's go create a new party here. We'll call this party Northwind for our organization. And you'll notice this little checkbox says local BizTalk processes messages received by this party. Essentially, what this checkbox is saying is, does this party represent the organization that owns this BizTalk, or rather, does this BizTalk system receive messages for this particular party? And since this is our party, we're going to leave that box checked. Now, there's additional properties that you can specify down here. These are just name value pairs. You'll notice if you've used previous versions of BizTalk that we don't have the identifiers here. Those are going to show up on the profiles, but we can add some additional properties just for notekeeping and for our own information. We do have the notion of relating particular send ports and certificates to this particular party so that as we get into dealing with encrypting and signing data, or we get into trying to resolve a particular send port for a party, we'll have that information available right here in the dialog. So let that party get created. Now, what you'll notice if we expand this is we have a profile that's been created for us, and we can go into that profile. Each party can have more than one profile, but when we create it, we're going to get a set of or a default profile that has some settings on it. So we can provide a description. Again, we have additional properties. But key to the profile then are these identities that we can create. So you can see here, there's a number of these prepackaged identities. So there's some BizTalk EDI from older versions. There's DUNS numbers, Department of Defense, you know, all sorts of different items in here. I'm going to go down to the mutually defined X12 here, and the qualifier is ZZ. I'm going to indicate that that's going to be Northwind. So this just indicates that we've kind of mutually defined identifiers between our organization and those that we're going to do business with. And we're just going to have a qualifier of ZZ and a value of Northwind in here. Let's create another party, somebody we can do some business with. And of course, we'll make that Contoso. Now I'm going to uncheck the box here because Contoso is an external party. They're not represented by this BizTalk. It's somebody we're going to be exchanging messages with. Of course, I could specify send ports and certificates for them as well. If we go into the Contoso profile, double click this time, I can also go create these identities. I can type in mutually defined, and for them we'll say that's Contoso. Now you can see we can have more than one identity as well. So we could have multiple identifiers, each with their individual qualifiers that would call out the specifics of this particular party and provide additional identifiers so that in different exchanges, we might use the mutually defined, or in another exchange, we might have different identifiers that we use. Now notice up here at the top, I have this add protocol settings. So I have transport settings, which includes AS2, and then I have encoding settings, or I can have the X12. And so this is where we get into overriding those fallback settings. So you can see over here, we have the common, we can give this a particular name if we want to. But these are going to be settings that we'll be able to create for this particular party. And notice that since we're giving it a name, we can create different protocol settings so that for different exchanges or for different interactions, we might have different collections of these things. And this name is what we're going to choose later when we start creating an agreement. Now notice over here, we have this notion of inbound and outbound settings. Inbound refers to messages that are going to be coming in to this organization. So in this particular case, since we're talking about Contoso, that's really about messages that are going to come from our BizTalk system, from Northwind, into Contoso. So these are settings that would apply when we have those types of exchanges. If we go to the outbound settings, notice that we can look here and see that we can specify things like additional identifiers. So they might just be things that are for X12. Right? So we have specific identifiers here in the ISA1 and ISA3 that we can specify that are just specific to X12. And we can also specify things here in terms of the acknowledgements and that we want to send back out, the envelopes that we want to use when we interact with this particular party, character sets and the separators. So we've really got a lot of control here over the messages that are going to be coming out of that system, and to also including the control numbers. Now you'll notice that some of these things are available and some of them aren't right now, just based on the setup that we've got for this organization and the fact that they are set up as an external organization. Let's take one more look here. We can also do validation. So on inbound, we can validate things like the interchange control numbers, the group and transaction set numbers as well. Notice, of course, that the local host settings are disabled because this organization isn't represented by the local host. So you can even see at the top, it indicates settings applicable for local BizTalk receive side processing. That doesn't make sense for this organization. So each of our organizations now, or each of our parties, has a profile. Now we can go in and create a new agreement. So based on that profile, I want to create a new agreement. I'll call that Contoso Northwind PO. We've got some agreement we're going to have around purchase orders. And now I need to select the protocol that we're using. Now when I choose X12, this is going to then leverage those settings that we've applied. So if we look at the first party, that's our Northwind party. Notice we didn't set up any particular settings here for that party. But when we look at Contoso, we have their particular profile there. Don't have too many options. But now we do see those X12 settings that we created show up. So this is how we leverage or use the protocol settings from that particular profile in an agreement. Over here on the contact information, you can see we've got the information for the agreement, right? So we can set up any number of contacts here for this particular agreement, who's responsible, who do we want to talk to about the purchase order process. And then again, any additional properties or any text of the agreement, anything you want to kind of store here together in this organization. Now, if you notice at the top, we have these two tabs. Now that we've chosen both parties, we have the Northwind to Contoso and Contoso to Northwind. So this is going to let us get into those protocol settings, the X12 settings, and really drill in and set those for the exchanges and set those for the communication based on who's the sender, who's the receiver. So the Northwind Contoso tab is going to let us apply settings for messages coming from our organization, Northwind, and going to Contoso. And those might be acknowledgments, those might be regular messages, as well as the tab for Contoso to Northwind that's going to allow us to specify the things coming from Contoso to our organization. So you'll see that these different settings around acknowledgments and identifiers, these are the same things that we got from the protocols. Right? We also have things like the send ports in here. For the transaction sets, we have the ability to look at the transaction set item. We can exclude some things. And this is where we can get into validation, where for particular transaction types, we can identify whether we want to do EDI or extended validation, how we want to handle leading and trailing zeros and the trailing separator. And then also for the local host settings now, this is coming from Contoso to Northwind. So these are going to be settings that are applied on the BizTalk side of things when these messages are received. Now, if you look at the target namespace here, you can see that we have this target namespace of BizTalk EDI X12 2006. And I can come in now and add, that's the default, but I can add additional ones here. So I could come find the 850, for example, the purchase order. And over here on the GS2, I can put Contoso. And now, let me specify here, I want to grab the base part of this, EDI X12, it's 2006, Contoso. So I'm customizing the namespace for the schema now. I'm saying when it's an 850 and it's from Contoso, in this agreement, I want to use a custom namespace. And so when it goes out to resolve that schema namespace, when this message is received, it's going to go use this namespace plus the information about the fact that it's an 850 and the other details of the exchange to go find that. So rather than looking for the default 850 schema, it'll find the one that's been set for this particular exchange with Contoso. Now I want to go back up to the identifiers and I just want to show you something here. If I take this value out, for example, and hit apply, one of the nice things about these tools for managing profiles and parties is we get error checking. So it's going to tell me that, hey, you're missing a mandatory field. Are you trying to set up this agreement, but you're missing this field for the identifier? You can't leave that blank. Now, if we go back and select that again and hit apply, everything gets applied correctly and it's happy to go and create that agreement. Now you'll notice if I go to the Contoso profile, I have the agreement shows up down here because that profile is part of it. And also if I go to the Northwind profile under Northwind, the agreement shows up there as well. So you can find it from either party there. And of course, for each party then, if I wanted to go create new profiles or new agreements, I can do that. Each party has the ability to manage many different profiles that they might apply with different external parties or other organizations. And we can have different agreements that we apply there as well. So we've created our two parties, one that represents our BizTalk system, or rather our BizTalk system represents the Northwind. They each have a profile where we can identify their settings for the different protocols, where we can create their identifiers. And we've created an agreement between the two that specifies some of those specific protocol settings, specifies that for the 850 exchange, we're going to use that custom namespace to go find and resolve that schema. In lesson three, our focus is going to be on the interchange processing. So we'll take a look at the schema resolution, how we find the right schema in BizTalk, how we create and manage our EDI schemas and work with those, the pipelines and the pipeline components and the promoted properties that are all related to EDI. It's really going to be focused on the schemas, the EDI messages, and how we map that notion of XML schemas into EDI and how those get processed. And we'll see then a demonstration of how to create an EDI schema. When a message arrives and it's being processed by the EDI pipelines, just like any other message, we need to resolve the schema that's been deployed to BizTalk that should be used for message parsing and message validation. And so to start, the group and transaction set values are pulled out of the EDI message, and those are going to be concatenated with the namespace URI. Now, the namespace URI is something that can be unique for a given party. So you can go into a particular party, you can create custom versions of certain schemas. So for example, for the X12, the 401-850 here, you could have an instance of that schema for partner A and a separate instance for partner B. They may have different schema validation messages or other settings that you have to tweak or change for those particular partners. We all know that even though we have EDI schemas, not everyone follows them exactly the same. And so this namespace policy allows you to provide a custom namespace and a custom schema then for each party. Now, if there isn't a namespace URI or custom schema defined for that party, it'll use the fallback settings and go find the global settings and look for that schema based on its original namespace. BizTalk itself ships with over 8,000 schemas, including a broad range of the EDIFACT and the X12 schemas. And they package these up because there's so many of them and they're so large, they actually pack these up in a self-extracting installer of Microsoft EDI XSD templates. Typically, what you'll do is expand that somewhere on an external drive or a separate hard drive, and you're only going to pull in the particular schemas that you want. You're never going to deploy all of the schemas. You're just going to deploy the schemas to BizTalk and in your particular projects that you actually are going to use and that you care about. So the first step would be to unzip those schemas somewhere. You're going to go start a BizTalk project in Visual Studio and add only those schema items that you need to the project. And then you, if you need to, you could customize those or modify those with the namespaces as appropriate for your parties that you're dealing with. And the other key things are that in addition to deploying your application, you're also going to have to add a BizTalk application reference in the administration console in order to use things like the EDI pipelines and other EDI components. All of those components, the pipelines and any EDI schemas that, you know, for context properties and things, are found in a special BizTalk application. And so in order to reference those, or in order to use those in your configuration of your application, you'll have to have that reference to the EDI application. Now, one of the things to watch for with these schemas is they can tend to be quite large. And so in some cases, you may have to use that as a reason to differentiate these schemas into different projects. You can pretty quickly hit a size limit on the .NET assemblies by putting too many of these EDI schemas in one BizTalk project. So if you're hitting that limitation, you may need to think about how do I best want to segregate or segment these things into individual schema projects. As I mentioned, we can take a particular schema and we can customize it for a partner. So we can add extra validation, we can change up the data types a bit. And when we do that, it's important to change the namespace on the schema and redeploy it. So in that scenario, you might have two different versions of the same schema deployed, each with a unique namespace, so that when we go to do the resolution of the schema, BizTalk can find the right schema for that partner. So two pieces of that, you create the schema, you're going to change the namespace URI for the partner, both in the schema, and then when you configure the partner and their profile, you're going to identify the schema namespace there in the party information. That way when BizTalk resolves who the sender is, it can look up the appropriate schema and then apply any extra validation or use the appropriate schema elements that you've modified for that partner. The BizTalk schema editor natively supports dealing with EDI documents, just like it does flat file documents. So it has an EDI editor extension. If you open up an EDI XSD from that extracted file, it's already going to be there. It's already been added in. But if you create a schema of your own, you need to go into the properties for the schema and add the EDI extensions on there. With these tools, with the schema tools, you can use the common validate instance and generate instance. They'll work at the XML level, but if you set them to the native, you can validate an EDI message or generate an EDI message. It just won't do anything with the interchange settings there. There's also a particular view in the schema editor, a tab view, that allows you to see the EDI context information and get a slightly different view over the schema as opposed to the XML schema view. A lot of the processing for EDI happens in the pipelines, and so we have a set of pipeline components for EDI processing. It involves the EDI disassembler. That's responsible for taking an EDI document and parsing through it and converting it to XML, doing property promotion. We also have the EDI assembler on the sending side, where we can take an XML document that matches an EDI schema and serialize it out to EDI, generate any of the interchange information. And we have a special component called the batch marker. This is going to perform some property promotion based on certain criteria we can set up in the party information to identify whether or not a particular message is going to be part of a batch. And we'll cover batch processing in a later module. Now, the EDI disassembler, as I mentioned, is where a bulk of the work happens. So it's already there in the EDI receive and AS2 EDI receive pipelines. So you don't have to create a custom one, but you can. And it does all of that conversion and debatching. It does the property promotion. And as we'll talk about in a bit, it can also be used to do acknowledgments for the EDI messages. So EDI-based acknowledgments. And I'll talk about those briefly in a moment. So BizTalk comes with the EDI receive pipeline and the EDI send pipeline. These include the disassembler and the assembler. It also can include does the debatching and the interchange processing. There's also a batch control message receive pipeline. This is one that's typically used when you're receiving control messages in. It's mostly used within BizTalk itself to handle control messages coming in to release a particular batch of messages out to the ultimate destination. When dealing with EDI, if we want to do message routing, we want to be able to get at particular promoted context properties, we've got a set of properties that are automatically promoted by that disassembler, including the ISA and the GS segments here and the ST01, and then for EDIFAC, some of the UMB 2, 3, and some of the other settings. So quite a bit of party information and other details there that you can pull out to do message routing at the messaging layer. You can also use those values if you need to within an orchestration by referencing the message and pulling those context properties off as well. Then we'll take a look at a demonstration where we're going to see how to add an EDI schema into the BizTalk project. We'll see how those EDI schema editor extensions get surfaced up through the schema editor within Visual Studio. We'll customize the schema a bit with some customizations and a unique namespace. Then we're going to deploy that, set up an EDI receive location, and test it out and see if we can receive the message in, resolve the party that we set up earlier, and process that EDI message and convert it into some XML. In this example, we'll be looking at how to create a custom schema, deploy it to BizTalk, and then how to receive an EDI message, process it using all of our party settings with the pipeline components, and see the result of that message as it gets processed through. We'll also see how to create subscriptions based on the EDI properties. So I've got an empty BizTalk project here, and I'm going to add an existing item. I'm going to go up here, and I'm going to choose this X12401850. This is a schema that's been extracted from the templates executable and just added here to make it simpler so I didn't have to go and use that huge file. And you can see if we look at that file out here, it's already 3 megabytes. So those files, those schema files, are pretty detailed. They have a lot of information in them. They can get large pretty fast. And that's just the text. As we go and build this up, our assembly also is going to have a considerable size. So we open this up. We'll see that we have a regular schema. It's going to open in the BizTalk schema editor. And we'll see the familiar tree view on the left-hand side. We'll see the schema view in the middle. You can see why this is so large, because there's a lot of detail there. And if I highlight that schema node then and come over here to the information about that, to the schema property, let me expand the properties window so you can see it here. You can see we have this property called schema editor extensions. And in there is the EDI schema editor extension. This works similar to the flat file extension. And what these are extensions to this tool, to the BizTalk editor, that enables additional properties in the property grid and knows how to take that additional information and serialize it into the XML schema. So we can see things in here such as, one, that we actually have the schema editor installed. But two, if we get down here, we'll see an annotation with some documentation that indicates this is an X12401850. And that's how those extensions work, is they annotate the schema. That means that the XML schema itself represents the XML instance of one of these EDI messages. And all of the annotations really help the pipeline components, the assembler and disassembler, know how to translate between XML and the EDI spec for this particular document. So we've got our extensions on there. The other thing this one adds is this additional tab down here, where now we can see we've got a different view over the schema. So we have the nodes, we have the information about the data type, the min occurs, max occurs, and min and max length. And then we also have this loop, where if we scroll down, we can see here that we've got this particular items participate in a loop, this SAC loop 1. If we click on that, we can see here we are in this CUR01, and that it's underneath this particular loop over here. All right, the loops generally indicate repeating structures. You can see here it has a max occurs of 25. Now we can also, if we come over here, we can see that for some of these properties, we've got the standard information here, but we also have extensions that are added in by EDI. And if I switch over to the categorized view, you'll see we've got some items here under BizTalk. We have this notion of a code list. Well, we can point to an MDB file. You can think of it as an Access database, basically, but a little database file where we can have lookup codes for these different fields. And so that gets added by those EDI extensions to the schema. That won't show up on a regular flat file schema or an XML schema, for example. And so the extensions add in all that functionality and that information. Now what I'm going to do is come up here to the schema. I'm going to go find the target namespace. We can see that that's got a default namespace in there. What I'm going to do is add to the end of that Contoso. I want to customize this schema for Contoso because I want to use this schema. I might want to go in and change some things in it. It's going to ask me if I want to clean up any global types. I'm just going to say okay, that I don't. I'm going to use this schema, which means now I have a custom schema for Contoso. I can change the validation. I can change any of the different rules in here because I'm just going to use this when I'm exchanging 850s with Contoso. Let's go ahead and deploy this now. And once we do, we should see that out in our BizTalk administration console. And what I'm going to do is create a receive location now to receive this purchase order, this 850, and I'll create a send port so that we can take that information and we can see it written out in its XML form. There we go. We'll come over and refresh the applications. Now we have an EDI receiving application. You can see here in the middle, we have our two parties, Contoso and Northwind out there that are going to participate. Now what I'm going to be receiving here is this sample PO. We take a look, this is an EDI 850. And we can see in here that we've got identifiers for the parties. So we have the ZZ indicating it's mutually agreed upon. And I've got Contoso and Northwind specified in there. And if we go down and look at the ST, we'll see that we're calling out that this is an 850. So this EDI document is going to come in and we're going to need to process that party information. And we're also going to need to find our schema now for Contoso for its version of the 850 and use that information in order to find the right schema and process this document. So let's do a new receive port. We'll call it EDI Contoso receive because that's who we're going to be receiving from. We'll do a new location. And so here we're going to pick up that file. We'll use the file transport. And we'll browse out here. We're going to go to our all files, demo code. We'll go down to ports. And here we're going to do EDI receive. Now we want to look for not .xml, but .text, and also go in and change some of the advanced settings. I want to make sure that it renames the file while it's processing it so I can see that, and I'll put the polling interval down lower here so if we have any issues, it'll pick that up a little quicker. Now notice that here I have only the options of pass-through receive and XML receive. What I really want is an EDI pipeline, but that's not available to me just yet. That's because all of those EDI pipelines are found in the BizTalk EDI application. So if I go up here and look under pipelines, we'll see here we've got the EDI receive and EDI send. We've got AS2 and some of these other BizTalk EDI specific pipelines. But because they're in this other application, I can't use them from my application just yet because I need to go and add a reference to that application. So I'm going to check that box and say from my EDI receiving application, my application, I want to reference that BizTalk EDI application. I'm essentially taking a dependency on that. And so now if I go back to my receive location, now you'll see that all those things from that referenced application show up. And so I can use the EDI receive pipeline on here. Now I've got a receive location. I want to set up a send port that's going to be able to get that information. So let's create a send port here and we'll call this EDI send. We'll use the file again. So go back to our all files, demo code, and we'll go into Northwind ports. And here we'll do the EDI send. Now we'll leave this as XML. We're going to let that come out as the XML file. So we're going to parse the EDI message into XML. And here we're going to see that raw XML come out there. So we'll just leave the pass through on there, but I'm going to apply a filter now. And rather than use the port name, I want to use some EDI information. So you can see I've got a number of different EDI properties that I can use. So things like the agreement, destination party information. I've got the GS segment qualifiers or qualifiers here. So I'm going to use GSO2. And I'm going to say that when that's equal to Contoso. So this is going to give me now that sending party, essentially, I'm creating a subscription for messages that come in from that party when it's processed by EDI and regardless of what port it comes in on. Let's go start our application. It's going to make sure that that referenced application is started in case we need things besides just pipelines, if we had orchestrations or things that we depended on from there as well. Now we could have unchecked that. We're just using the pipeline, so we don't need to process that. But in this case, I just left that checked. Now I want to test this out. So let's go back to our folders here. I'm going to take this sample PO and copy it over here to the EDI receive. We can see BizTalk's already picked it up and started working on it. It's changed the name there. And now it's going to go out and look at that identifier information, try and resolve the party. It's going to find that it's between Contoso and Northwind, should find the appropriate schema for that and be able to resolve that message. And then it should send the message out here to our send port, giving us the XML instance of that file. Now, if we look at this file that we get out, this should be the XML representation of our file. So we can see it's parsed that EDI into the XML. We've got the STO1 here is correct. It's an 850. We look down through, we'd see the other details that map up there as well to the purchase order items that came through. So we could take this now, it's an XML document that was published. We could do maps against it. We can do any kind of XML processing now that we've received that EDI document into BizTalk server. In our fourth lesson, we want to focus on EDI acknowledgments, debatching of messages where we may have a number of different messages within a given interchange, subdocument splitting or taking individual pieces of the message and splitting them out based on subdocuments, and we'll also see how BizTalk enables reporting on your EDI interchanges through the management console. And then we'll take a look through the demonstration at that reporting and those acknowledgments getting applied. Acknowledgements in EDI enable a receiving organization to send back an acknowledgement indicating that they've received a particular message. Now, depending on the type of interchange you're doing, the protocols that you're using, there's different types of acknowledgements that can be sent. So for example, based on the ISA 14, you could get a technical acknowledgement or you can get a 997. Right? When you get into EDIFACT, you can get a technical or functional ACK based on that UNB9 setting. Now, if you have a one-way receive port and you have things set up to generate acknowledgements, obviously they can't go back to the sender. It's one way. Maybe you're pulling a message off of FTP, for example. And in that case, the acknowledgements still get generated by the disassembler and sent into the message box. What you need to do then is have a subscriber, a send port or an orchestration that's watching for those acknowledgements, can pick those up and then send them to the appropriate destination. So it's possible that you'd pick those up in an orchestration, do some dynamic addressing and send that back to the ultimate sender, or you may just use some messaging and routing to handle those acknowledgements and send them back. On a request response receive port, the default is that acknowledgements are going to get routed back to the send pipeline. So they would get passed back to the caller as the response to their request. Now you can turn that off, you can disable that in the acknowledgement settings, and then you kind of fall back to the same model that you have with one-way ports, where if the ACKs aren't going to go directly back to the sender, they're going to go get published into the message box. You need to have a subscriber then to handle those acknowledgements. The EDI disassembler is set up such that it will split EDI documents if you set it up to do so. So you can, for the X12s, you can split on that ST or SE level, for the EDIFACT at the UNH or UNT level. And you can set this up at the party level. So you're going to see different settings here in terms of, do I want to split the interchange at the transaction set? Do I want to preserve the interchange? Right, you can see here that what that means is, do I suspend the whole interchange on error, or do I suspend the individual transaction sets on error? So in that case, the interchange itself would continue, but the transaction sets would be dropped off and reported as errors. So you could have some transaction sets succeed and others that would fail. And when you get into the HIPAA scenarios, the HIPAA schema itself, those schemas have the ability to set up what's known as a sub-document break. So at the schema level, you first have to call out that yes or no, I don't want to do sub-document breaking. And then at the appropriate record, you can indicate whether or not that's a place where the break can happen. Do I want to create breaks at this particular point? So it's kind of a two-step process here. But again, this is functionality brought over from the accelerators to enable the sub-document splitting, which is common with these HIPAA schemas. With all of the party resolution and the acknowledgments going on and a lot of things happening under the covers for you within those pipelines, it's important to get a view of what's happening in the system with these different interchanges. And so in the management console, in the BizTalk server administration console, the group hub page has a set of reporting elements or reporting links focused on the EDI exchanges. All of this builds on top of BizTalk's business activity monitoring. So it sets up BAM views and BAM activities and writes to those as part of the EDI processing to give you a sense of how many transaction sets have completed, you know, with acknowledgments sent back and that sort of information. In order to turn on the reporting, you actually have to go back into those global settings or those fallback settings and make sure you enable the reporting. Some people don't want it on, they don't want any overhead at all, even though it's limited and asynchronous reporting. They want to turn that stuff off because they don't tend to use it. So you can go in and decide whether you want to enable that reporting or not. Now, the management console provides one view over that data, but because it is related to BAM and it's stored in the BAM infrastructure, you can go write your own queries over the views that are created. You can go create reports with your favorite reporting tool or other tools to go and query out and view that information about what's happened in your EDI transactions. In this demonstration, we're going to take a look at turning on that EDI reporting, setting up our acknowledgments, then we're going to test our application that we've had before and validate that we get acknowledgments going through and that the reporting is happening and we can go in and view the report data. In this example, we'll be looking at EDI reporting and acknowledgments. Now on the parties node, I'm going to go to the X12 fallback settings, and I'm going to need to enable reporting at the general level up here. You can see I have this checkbox to activate the EDI reporting. Now I could also check the box here to store the transaction set or payload for reporting, but for me, I just want the higher level details. I'm also going to go into the EDIFACT settings and do the same here. So for both protocols, I want to enable the reporting. Now that's the fallback settings. I'm also going to come into my agreement and I'm going to enable the reporting here. So on these general properties, I have the turn on reporting checkbox down here under the common host settings. So the fallback settings enable reporting across the board for the particular protocols, but on a given agreement, we also want to go in and turn on reporting for that agreement. Now up here on the Contoso Northwind tab, so for interchanges where we're receiving messages here in our Northwind, I want to come down to the acknowledgements, and I'm going to check the box that indicates that a 997 is expected. And what that means is that when Contoso sends an interchange to Northwind, it's expecting a 997 acknowledgement, and I want to make sure that that information gets sent. Now I can look here on the, wrong localhost settings. If I look here on the localhost settings, you can see I have this checkbox to route the acknowledgement to the send pipeline on request response receive port. I'm going to go ahead and uncheck that. I do have a one-way port, but I know for this agreement that I'm always going to have that one-way port. So I want to make sure that acknowledgements always get sent to the message box so that I can set up a subscriber for them. Now you'll notice on the Northwind Contoso, this is now when Northwind or my organization is sending things to Contoso. I want to go down and choose send ports. So I don't have a send port here yet. I'll create a new send port. And it's going to ask me what application I want to add that port to. So I'll add it to my existing EDI application that I have here. And I want to create a one-way send port. It's going to give me the dialog here now. So I can say this is my acknowledgement port. I'm going to use the file. And we'll browse out here now to the directory. We'll do the EDI send, and just to differentiate the acknowledgement from the regular messages, we'll put the ACK in front of it so we know that that happens to be an acknowledgement. Now on the filters, I'm going to want to receive particular acknowledgements here, and so I'm going to use those EDI context properties to do some routing here. I've got a variety of EDI values that I can choose from. So I'm going to look here for the GSO3. I'm just going to indicate who I'm going to be sending this to. So that's going to be Contoso. That's who I'm sending this value to. And then I'm going to add in, I'm going to use the ST01 here, and I'm going to indicate that it's a 997. So I've specified that it's an acknowledgement. It's a 997. That's the document information, and it's going to Contoso here. That's my filter information. I'll click OK. We've got all that information set up now on our parties. And what we'll find is if we go to Contoso and look at this organization, let me do a refresh here. Go into Contoso and look at the send ports. That acknowledgement port that we sent up has automatically been associated now with the Contoso party. Because it was on the tab, Northwind to Contoso, we know that this is a send port that's going to go to Contoso. Now let's test out these acknowledgements a little bit. Should be able to send our purchase order in to the receive. And when that gets picked up by BizTalk then, we should see that come out the other side. Make sure that we've got everything started here. I do want to start the new send port that I created. And I'll make sure that my host instance is started as well. Now we see that BizTalk has started processing that file. Should pick it up. And what we should get is both the message itself, the EDI message that we've processed and turned into XML, but we should also see an acknowledgement that's going to come out there. And there's our acknowledgement document. And if we take a look at that, we'll see there's a 997. And we've got the information here that it was a PO that came in. We've got some other acknowledgement values that get provided there. Well, let's go in and take a look at the reports as we go to the BizTalk group. Kind of hidden down here at the bottom are all these EDI status reports. So we've got the reports that we're used to using for suspended messages and running interchanges. But I want to come down here and find some of the interchange and correlated ACK status. I'll see right now I'm not getting anything. But if I change the date, We'll use a date that's actually in the interchange. Let's run that query. Let's get all of these. You can see there's our Contoso to Northwind with a control ID, direction of receive, and we've got some interchange data there and the interchange status of accepted. Now, notice that the interchange date is this 10-2-2010. The reason that's different is that's the date that's actually in our document. So if we go look at our sample PO, we're going to find in here a date that specifies that. So there's 10-02-10-2010. So we've got that information in there, and that's what's used as the interchange date time. So you may run into some issues where you're filtering for things that you received yesterday, but it also depends on the date that's actually in the documents that you're receiving. Now, if we go back here to the group hub, we've got some other reports that we can use. Let's do an interchange aggregation report. And again, we'll change that date back to include that interchange that we've got there. Now we can see that we have this count of interchanges between these different parties and the direction over here, and the earliest started and latest end date. So we get kind of a roll up here of these particular items. Now if we go back and we send some more data through, we've got another one here. Let's come back and run the query. Should see this change from one interchange to two. So again, it's not a detailed report. It's not giving us a list of those things, but it's giving us a count of interchanges between these particular organizations or these particular parties. So that gives you a sense of the reporting capabilities where we can go in and find these interchanges, find the information, how we set up the acknowledgments, and we can set those up to be published. And then we use regular subscriptions to send those out through the specific send ports, where we've associated those through the agreement with a particular party. In this lab, you're going to get a chance to configure and deploy an EDI schema into BizTalk server and set up your application. And you'll create the parties that are receiving and sending those messages along with their profile and agreement information, and test out the application to make sure that you can receive messages into BizTalk that are using EDI and correctly resolve those parties and process the messages.